Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome tonight's MC, WESH 2 Orlando news anchor, Jim Payne.
Well, good evening, everyone. For those of you who were at the ceremony this morning, it's good to see you all again. We have a great night planned, so let's get started. Would you please rise and join me in honoring the current members of the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame as they walk the red carpet. Please remain standing for the presentation of the colors by the Cocoa Beach High School Junior ROTC with the national anthem sung by Cadet Caitlin Agundez.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say
Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. Thank you once again to the Cocoa Beach High School Junior ROTC and to Caitlin Agundez for tonight's presentation of the colors and the national anthem. How about another round of applause for them? It is an honor to be here tonight to celebrate these two distinguished individuals as the newest inductees into the prestigious United States Astronaut Hall of Fame. Tonight's gala is presented by the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation in conjunction with Delaware North Companies and Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex. Proceeds from tonight's event will benefit the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation. It truly is a privilege to take part in tonight's gala with an audience of the very best and brightest astronaut scholars, world-renowned corporations, as well as a group of amazing foundation supporters. Please enjoy the first course in front of you as we begin tonight's program, and make sure to save that champagne-filled flute in front of you. Resist the temptation. We will call on it later. We do have some very special guests this evening, along with these fine gentlemen and ladies who just walked the red carpet. Well, all those here tonight representing the Kennedy Space Center, Johnson Space Center, Glenn Research Center, and NASA headquarters, please stand to be recognized. We thank you for celebrating with us this evening. It is our privilege to have some very special guests joining us this evening as family representatives of some very recognizable U.S. Hall of Fame astronauts. Please welcome Rick Armstrong, representing his late father, Gemini and Apollo astronaut Neil Armstrong. Laura Shepherd Churchley, representing her late father, Mercury and Apollo astronaut, and Astronaut Scholarship Foundation founder, Alan Shepherd. Thank you all for being here tonight and for your representation of the legacy of those brave pioneers who wrote the history of space exploration. At this time, we'd like to recognize special astronauts in our attendance today. Please welcome the following Space Shuttle astronauts: astronaut Gary Payton, accompanied by his wife, Sue. Astronaut Bruce Melnick. Astronaut Sam Durrance. Astronaut Tony Antonelli. We'd now like to introduce the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame members who are in attendance tonight. They will be announced in flight order. Gemini and Apollo astronaut General Tom Stafford, accompanied by his wife Linda. Apollo astronaut Al Warden. Was Al just making it rain? Was that what I just witnessed? Skylab and Shuttle astronaut Jack Lausma. Apollo-Soyuz test project and shuttle astronaut Vance Brand, accompanied by his wife, Bev. Shuttle astronaut Carol Bo Bobko, accompanied by his wife, Diane. Shuttle astronaut Dan Brandenstein. Shuttle astronaut Brewster Shaw, accompanied by his wife, Kathy. Shuttle astronaut Robert Hoot Gibson. Shuttle astronaut Kathy Sullivan. Shuttle astronaut Lauren Shriver. Shuttle astronaut Jeffrey Hoffman, accompanied by his wife, Barbara. Shuttle astronaut Ray Seddon. Shuttle astronaut Fred Gregory, accompanied by his wife, Annette. Shuttle astronaut Jerry Ross. Shuttle astronaut Charlie Bolden. Shuttle astronaut Franklin Chang Diaz, accompanied by his wife, Peggy. Shuttle astronaut and current NASA director at Kennedy Space Center, Bob Cabana. Yeah. Shuttle astronaut Frank Culbertson. Shuttle astronaut and Astronaut Scholarship Foundation, Kurt Brown, accompanied by his wife, Mary. Shuttle astronaut Ellen Ochoa. Shuttle astronaut Charlie Precourt, accompanied by his wife, Lynn. Shuttle astronaut Tom Jones. Shuttle astronaut Kent Rominger, accompanied by his wife, Mary Sue. Shuttle astronaut Steve Lindsay, accompanied by his wife, Diane. Shuttle astronaut Scott Altman, accompanied by his wife, Jill. Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause for our U.S. Hall of Fame astronauts. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the moment we have all been waiting for. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the 2019 U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame inductees. Ladies and gentlemen, James Buckley. James Buckley was selected as an astronaut candidate in 1979. During his tenure with NASA, he flew on 4 space shuttle missions, spent 20 days in space traveling more than 7.74 million miles in 319 Earth orbits. He's a distinguished aviator with a career of 4,200 hours of flying time, 4,000 of which were in a jet aircraft. His missions had several firsts. STS-51C Discovery was the dedicated Department of Defense mission. STS-61A Challenger was the first to carry 8 crew members, the largest crew to fly in space, and the first in which payload activities were controlled from outside of the United States. James is accompanied by his wife, Jean. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome 2019 U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame inductee, James Buckley. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Janet Cavandi. Janet Cavandi flew 3 space shuttle missions and spent 33 days in space, traveling more than 13.1 million miles in 535 Earth orbits. She served as a mission specialist in the last joint operations on Mir, the Russian space station. Aboard her second mission, the mapping of more than 47 million miles of the Earth's land surface provided accurate 3-dimensional topographical map data that's used for smartphone maps and military software today. She currently serves as director of NASA's Glenn Research Center in Cleveland, Ohio. Janet is accompanied by her husband, John. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome 2019 U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame inductee, Janet Cavandi. Please be seated. It is now my pleasure to welcome our first presenter for this evening's program. Now it is my pleasure to welcome our first presenter for this evening's program. He is the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation's chairman. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Kurt Brown.
Thank you, Jim. Good evening, everyone. What a pleasure it is to be here with you. Remember that champagne on your table and that you weren't supposed to drink? Did anybody drink it? Well, too bad. Would you please join me in raising the commemorative champagne glass gifted from the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex to salute our newest members of the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame. Today, we are honored to celebrate Jim and Janet's incredible accomplishments, dedication, and contributions to space exploration. Hear, hear. It is with great pleasure that I get to welcome to the podium the woman leading the the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation's mission, Tammy Sudler, our Chief Executive Officer.
So as we celebrate tonight, I'm honored by those in attendance who have all taken part in the exploration and the innovation that continues to inspire future generations. It is also through the support of the companies here tonight that the astronaut scholars continue to change the world. I would like now to give a special thank you to tonight's corporate sponsors. Our Hall of Fame sponsors, AirScan and Scotty Group. Our induction sponsors, AECOM, Embraer, and Lockheed Martin. And our gala sponsors, Boeing, BRPH, Jacobs, Sweetwater Episcopal Academy, Space Coast Office of Tourism, United Launch Alliance, Wells Fargo, and Zen Technologies. I'd also like to thank our partner and host hotel, Courtyard by Marriott Cocoa Beach. Our in-kind sponsors this evening, Carousel Florist, Rocket Science Wine by Caldwell Vineyard, Florida Beer Company, and a special thank you to Stephen Torres and Emily Jordan for capturing tonight's photography. But all of this wouldn't be possible without our volunteers, our ASF staff, and our Delaware North team. So thank you very, very much to everybody who made this possible. And if you haven't done so already, and we've got some time to do this, I'd like to ask you to visit our table in the rear of the room for your chance to enter in the raffle for the Earthrise canvas signed by various Mercury, Gemini, Apollo, and Shuttle astronauts, and also the opportunity to purchase the Apollo 11 50th anniversary coin. It's produced by the U.S. Mint. It's a commemorative coin. It's beautiful. If you haven't seen it, please go look at it. The surcharges from that benefit the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation, the National Air and Space Museum, and the Astronaut Memorial Foundation. So please go back there, take a look at everything, and thank you for your support, and enjoy your dinner as it'll be served shortly.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to go ahead and get started with the rest of the program right now. At this time, I would like to welcome ASF's 2014 and 2015 astronaut scholar from Ohio State University, Jillian Yuricich.
Good evening, everyone, and congratulations again to our deserving inductees for their acceptance to the Astronaut Hall of Fame. My name again is Jillian Yuricich, and I have the pleasure of addressing you tonight as a 2014 and 2015 recipient of the Astronaut Scholarship from the Ohio State University. Can I get an OH? IO, there it is, great. So I come to you today not as a seasoned professional, but as a young engineer who was deeply inspired by this prodigious rocket under which we are dining. I used to regret not having been an aerospace engineer during the reign of the Saturn V. To make it worse, I watched Space Shuttle retire as I packed my bags for college. I really thought I missed the best days of launch vehicle development. Boy, was I wrong. I currently have the privilege of working as a trajectory analysis engineer at SpaceX. Every day, thank you. Every day I'm greeted at work by a rocket slightly smaller than this one, a Falcon 9 rocket standing on landing legs outside my office. I walk by SpaceX Mission Control to get my morning coffee and my afternoon coffee and sometimes my evening coffee. When I need to stretch my legs, I take a stroll around the factory floor and watch as Merlin engines are built before my very eyes. I used to watch SpaceX launches from my dorm room and my laptop. Now I watch them from behind the tall glass walls of our mission control as telemetry streams in real time. But I didn't just wish this life of mine into existence. It's a bit more complicated than that. All throughout my childhood, astronomy, science, and stories of exploration dominated my free time and my imagination. I read about philosophers of old who thought the Earth was suspended in an orb with the sun orbiting beyond. I found it fascinating that it took centuries to disprove that idea. I read about our ever-expanding universe and the clouds of gas, swirling galaxies, burning stars, and countless planets that inhabit it. I discovered each generation has a growing sense of humility as we discover just how little we really know. I learned about mathematicians and scientists and adventurers, Muhammad al-Khwarizmi, the father of algebra in the 9th century, Nicholas Copernicus and his radical sun-centered universe, early navigators like Ferdinand Magellan and his circumnavigation of the world, and Ernest Shackleton's misadventures in the Antarctic. The stars guided both of those nautical explorers, though one to glory and one to safety. Something about these facts and stories were more romantic to me than my favorite book, Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice, or Shakespeare's 116th sonnet. And so, in knowing this, surely you can predict how I must have reacted, learning about the greatest voyagers of our time, our astronauts. It was practically a religious experience, greater than my young mind could wrap around at the age of 6, and one that left an indelible mark on my life. So fast forward just a few years to my junior year in college. It was January, and I had returned to school from an internship with NASA Ames in the San Francisco Bay. My research there on turbulent airflow characterization in the largest wind tunnel in the world was recently published, and about the same time, my mentor and thermodynamics professor, Dr. Mei Zhuang, had me visit her office. She told me she nominated me for something called the Astronaut Scholarship, and I would need to fill out the rest of the paperwork on my own. The minute she said astronaut, though, that was pretty much all the convincing I needed. Because the deadline was fast approaching, I toiled over a full weekend to retrieve all the documents and dot the I's to a very personal statement. I submitted it with a recommendation from Dr. Zhuang, the only female aerospace professor I ever had. I was quite proud of the package I pulled together and thought the only thing missing was a little red bow. So months later, I went home to visit my dad while my mom was out of town. When checking the mail, he found a small envelope with the ASF logo perched in the corner. Now, you need to understand how college applications had groomed us. We were in the business of expecting big manila envelopes that weighed 5 pounds with paper. That was the sign of good news. This ASF letter was no such behemoth. It was a slim, white envelope with a single page inside, all of which went against our manila criteria. My dad looked at me like, well, this probably isn't good news, but at least they had the courtesy to reject you with a formal letter and put you out of your misery. Ever the optimist he is. I opened the letter, of course, anyway, and let out a squeal, and read the congratulatory words out loud to the man who built model airplanes and rockets with me, who attended father-daughter space camp in Huntsville, Alabama with me, and who was paying expensive college fees and campus housing for me. Imagine just what his face looked like when I told him he wouldn't need to pay for that anymore. Now pan to my sister's face when she found out she wouldn't have to take out excessive student loans because mom and dad could focus their full effort on helping her pay for school. This little letter in a little white envelope just moved mountains for an entire family. The power of the pen, as they say. Of course, the first phone call after was to my mom and her business trip in Chicago. I did not need the phone to hear her cheers. What that little letter didn't prepare me for, however, was just how involved the scholarship's namesakes were. If we quickly recap on the first part of my speech, you'll recall that I feel very intensely about the subject of space exploration and astronauts. Through ASF, I was assigned a mentor, an astronaut mentor, in fact. Now, I did get stuck with Kurt, whose most redeeming quality is Mary, but it was still something. He's gonna get me back for that one. Only last November, I met the man whose family was an individual contributor to my scholarship. His father passed away, and in his memory, the family funded 2 astronaut scholars. I was handpicked by them to carry out their father's legacy of innovation and engineering. I could not then, when I met this gentleman, and as much as I tried to give you the full picture of my life and how hard I worked to get here, I don't think I can even now fully communicate the importance of this scholarship. It lifted up my family. It provided to me a trove of mentors and friends whose guidance and advice I truly treasure. It told me that despite my own doubts, I am deserved of commendation. This is a foundation that rewards the results of the extraordinary efforts of vigorous young minds, and it is truly an honor to be counted among them. If you too are an astronaut scholarship recipient here with us tonight, please stand and be recognized. I promised myself on my first trip to the Astronaut Hall of Fame ceremony that I wouldn't be a fangirl. I was determined to keep it cool. But that didn't mean I wasn't entirely in awe, especially when it came to meeting the core of female astronauts who I idolized completely. I met Eileen Collins, a name I memorized very early on in life, and was able to tell her in person just how much it meant to meet her and thank her, knowing she helped pave the way for not just female astronauts, but women everywhere. All those stories and adventures I listed earlier were from a time when women only dreamed of being a part of such endeavors or helping to unearth the solutions to physics' most complex mysteries. And if by some miracle they were involved, they hardly ever lived to see themselves receive an iota of credit. I stand on the shoulders of those incredible goddesses of science, engineering, and spaceflight, both known and forgotten, but we live in a time not completely devoid of biases against women in STEM. We all live in a time where women achieving firsts for their gender is still newsworthy. We're still waiting on that all-female spacewalk. I want to live in a time where we run out of firsts to celebrate for women. I want us to get all caught up. Because now that women and minorities of several other demographics have the opportunity to be involved, I think we can truly begin to celebrate achievements for all of humankind. Tonight, we simultaneously celebrate the achievements of our past and extend our gratitude to those who laid the foundation in human spaceflight, while also looking to a future of firsts for humanity, where my generation will push us farther, innovate faster, save more lives from poverty and disease, build smarter and greener cities, explore deeper into the universe, and achieve what generations before us could scarcely imagine. There is so much more for me to do and learn and see, but when I think of all the launches I've watched from outside SpaceX Mission Control, the roar of the rocket nearly indistinguishable with that of my coworkers' cheers, our Falcon rocket shrinking into the black of night, I cannot believe I am living this incredible life. I was just a girl with a telescope who suffered through many an Ohio's winter night to get a glimpse at my favorite constellation, the Pleiades. I was just a girl who sketched rockets and planes and planets in the margins of her notebooks. I was just a girl who, without shame, wouldn't leave the air show until I had every Blue Angel pilot's autograph. All of who I am today started with that little hopeless romantic of a child who was enraptured by what she saw through her telescope, who was rejected by the SpaceX internship program 17 times before landing a full-time position, and who is forever indebted to this foundation established by her heroes. The Astronaut Scholarship's confidence in me invigorated a confidence in myself I had never known before. I know unequivocally now I'm on exactly the right path. It's led me here. More importantly, though, this path, the one I dreamed of walking since I was 6, is the one I paved for myself with the memories of that tenacious girl, with the love of my family, and now forevermore with the support of the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation always at my back. Thank you.
Thank you, Jillian. All I gotta say is I must be a really good mentor. But Jillian has become like a second daughter to us, so you're grounded. For the rest of the weekend, anyway. I've been here a number of years, and we have our scholars speak to our gala. And I tell you what, if Jillian's speech does not move you to show you what great things that we do here at our foundation, nothing in the world will move you. Please, another one for Jillian. It's hard to follow that, and unfortunately, on a different note here, at this time, we would like to take a moment to remember those who we have recently lost. These gentlemen were passionate about space, science, and the next generation. During their careers and lifetime, they have inspired many young people to pursue their passions. While these gentlemen are no longer with us, their legacy lives on through the astronaut scholars who have been supported and inspired by all of them. Alan Bean, a pioneering astronaut, he was the fourth person to walk on the moon, responsible for installing several surface experiments and the first nuclear-powered generator station on the lunar surface. He went on to command the second Skylab crew, and when retired, he continued his life journey by painting all the remarkable worlds and sights that he had experienced. Don Peterson, a mission specialist on STS-6, the maiden flight of Challenger, he conducted an extravehicular activity, an EVA, we call it, commonly called a spacewalk, to test a new spacesuit, the shuttle airlock, and the tools and techniques for construction and repair outside a spacecraft. He logged 4 hours, 15 minutes in extravehicular activity and a total of 120 hours in space. Richard Searfoss, logging more than 5,000 hours flight time in 56 different aircraft, his exceptional piloting and commanding skills helped lay the groundwork for much of the human exploration and research activities we continue to pursue today on the International Space Station. Let's take a moment of silence and remembrance of these gentlemen. Thank you.
I would like to introduce now our next guest speaker for the evening. Please welcome Theron Protzy, the Chief Operating Officer of the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex.
Boy, you know, I got to talk to Tammy and Kurt. Following these astronaut scholarship participants is just not easy. You know, the last year was the gentleman who created Oros, and now Jillian, what a speech. So I'm going to make it very simple, very short, and very sweet, you know, and it is with great honor, you know, in the moment of silence to talk about these fallen heroes. You know, and I just look back to Alan Bean's portrait, which we brought in from the old Astronaut Hall of Fame, and we took great care to bring it and put it in pride here at the Apollo Saturn V Center. So we're excited to have that, as well as everything else that we're planning to do before the 50th of this year. But I just want to welcome everybody this evening. It is our honor to host today's ceremony and gala, and to welcome NASA's astronauts James Buckley and Janet Cavandi into the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame. What a great honor. And it's so great to see all these heroes here this evening, to just watch them come down the red carpet as they truly deserve. At the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex, our goal is to tell the NASA story in the most compelling and immersive way possible. We continue to honor NASA's heritage and bright future by giving anyone who visits the chance to truly understand the value of the achievements that space travel has brought to humankind. You may have noticed some new exhibits walking around today, enhancements that are underway just about in every aspect of our complex. And we are currently reimagining the Apollo Saturn V Center to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the iconic Apollo 11 mission this year. Basically, the entire outside and inside will look completely different by June 1st. You're starting to see a little bit of the sprinkles come in. The new exhibits are about ready, and it'll all come in. And by June 1st, this place will look like nothing that it is now, and it will definitely honor the 50th anniversary. We're so excited that the command service module over here is going to get an all-new exhibit, as well as we brought the LEM down in a pit right down where this command service module used to be, and it's getting a whole iconic exhibit to really emphasize the overall mission. So I hope you all can come back in July and really see everything that we're doing. And by the way, right outside there is a moon tree garden, where you can walk and see the 12 trees, the moon trees, that represent each one of the Apollo missions. So we're really excited about everything that's happening. And we're all doing a whole bunch of new interactives and technology to enhance the storytelling of the Apollo program. We're also including a new sense of arrival and even a 1960s living room recreation to experience what it was like to watch the moon landing. So if anybody's got any avocado orange furniture hanging around, bring it to us. We'd love to put it into the exhibit. So where's Al Warden? I think Al. So still got some of that hanging around, Al? There are even more innovations that are currently on the horizon. We're really excited about what's happening. There's so many new things that are going to happen. And, you know, Jillian talking about SpaceX, our new building that's going up in the main complex, we're really hoping to have SpaceX, Blue Origin, all the new and the next of what's happening in NASA and the Commercial Crew Program. Very, very exciting. Delaware North, my company, is proud to sponsor the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation Gala. We value the relationship of the foundation, and we look forward to continuing that work with ASF into the future. Thank you for putting such a fine event tonight. It's absolutely amazing, and inviting us to be a part of it. Thank you all for being here today and this evening. And once again, congratulations to this year's inductees, James Buckley and Janet Cavandi. Thank you very much, and have a great evening.
Theron, thank you very much. It is my pleasure to introduce tonight's next presenter, a veteran of four space flights. He has logged over 910 hours in space. He served as pilot on missions STS-41 and STS-53, and as mission commander on STS-65 and STS-88, STS-88 being the first International Space Station assembly mission. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Hall of Fame astronaut and NASA Kennedy Space Center Director, Bob Cabana.
Oh, thank you, Jim. Hey, first off, as the Kennedy Center Director, I want to say what a great partnership we have with ASF and Delaware North. And how about a round of applause for Delaware North and this outstanding meal that we shared tonight. So it's a real pleasure for me to be here this evening to introduce Jim Buckley. Before I get started, though, I got to congratulate Janet Cavandi. Janet is one of my favorite people. I was so glad to see her get into the Astronaut Hall of Fame. And from me to you, Janet, congratulations. Outstanding. So I arrived at the Naval Academy 3 weeks after Jim graduated in 1967. Now, Jim went off to the basic school and the infantry officer's course at Quantico, Virginia, and then he commanded a platoon in Vietnam before he realized that flying jets over the jungle was a lot better than slogging through it on foot, okay? Now, this proved that Jim had a brain. And that's really impressive for someone who went to high school in Fargo, North Dakota. But it also set the stage for the greater things that were coming in Jim's career. After earning his wings as a naval flight officer, he went on to get his master's degree, and then he served as a radar intercept officer in a number of Marine F-4 squadrons. Then in 1977, he went off to Navy Test Pilot School in Patuxent River. When NASA went out to recruit that first group of shuttle astronauts in 1977-78, Jim was ready, and he applied. He met all the qualifications and eventually became one of the 35 new guys in 1978. That's what TFNG stood for in the astronaut office, right, Jim? Now, I didn't get to NASA until the June of 1985, and Jim was already training for his second space shuttle mission, flying two of them in 1 year. After serving as the flight engineer on STS-51C, his first mission that deployed a classified DoD payload, he was then assigned to the critical flight engineer role again on the first German D-1 Space Lab mission aboard Challenger. There's that first word again. I didn't see a whole lot of him when I first got to NASA because he was busy training. But I remember going to his crew's post-flight party and to his debrief in the astronaut office. And I thought at the time, seeing him as one of my heroes, a leader in the astronaut office, I was looking forward to the day when I had that opportunity to do what he was doing. And it wasn't just that Jim was busy training that I didn't get to interact with him. I mean, after all, he was a colonel in the United States Marine Corps, and I was just a lowly major. And not only that, I was an ASCAN, lower than that. What would a colonel want to do with me, a lowly ASCAN? Well, as I learned later, being a colonel in the astronaut office really isn't that big a deal. My pilot, Rick Sturko, on my last flight, he used to say, "You can't swing a dead cat around here without hitting a colonel." Well, following the D-1 mission, Jim went on to fly two more challenging missions with deployable payloads, always performing flawlessly as the flight engineer in the MS-2 seat. Sharing his knowledge and space experience with the rookies on his crew that have the benefit and privilege of flying with him. Over time, I got to know Jim better. He's a good, solid Midwesterner, a meat and potatoes kind of guy with honest values and integrity. And although he's from North Dakota, I believe he really likes my home state of Minnesota more. And that's because the fishing is better. And Jim has spent a lot of time in Minnesota fishing. I remember one thing really well, and that was the holiday parties that he and Jeannie used to host. They were always warm and inviting. Jim is a friend you can count on. He'd do anything for you that's within his power if you asked him, and he'd try even if it wasn't. It's hard to come up with stories about Jim because he's such a nice guy and he's so darn sharp. There is one time, though. I'll never forget this. It was when he was a senior Marine, and he made all of us get dressed in our camouflage utilities, put camo paint grease on our faces, and go out in the woods with 782 gear in a Humvee that he commandeered from the Marine Reserve Unit in Houston, I don't know how he got it, to have our Marine group astronaut photo taking. Now, what that had to do with being an astronaut, I'll never know. But that's what he wanted us to do. And I guess deep down, Jim is still a grunt at heart, and flying in space was just making sure that he could secure the ultimate high ground. Jim's had an amazing career as a Marine, an astronaut, and a senior executive with Boeing, excelling in every step along the way. But I think if you ask Jim what means more to him than anything else on Earth, more than the success he's had on his four space flights, he'd say it was his family. His wife Jeannie, his son Jim, his daughter Jennifer, who's smarter than both of us, and his grandchildren. They are truly the love of his life. Let's take a minute to look at this video that highlights Jim's career.
has to prepare for these. Tripping in the world could be danger bees. Everybody circling his vultures. Negative, nepotist. Everybody waiting for the fall of man. Everybody praying for the end of times. Everybody hoping they could be the one. I was born to run, I was born for this.
Whip, whip, run me like a race horse. Pull me like a rip horse.
Make me every bit me up.
I wanna be the slip, slip. Word up on your lip, lip. Better that you rip.
I'd like to introduce to you the best Space Lab crew that's ever formed. Jim Buckley, mission specialist, we headed up the red team for the orbiter.
I've always had a thing about Jim having bigger arms than I have, and I thought I'd set out to correct that on this mission, but it didn't work.
I've never seen people work in the Space Lab as hard as they did, but the results speak for themselves.
Launch for the shuttle program during 1989.
3, 2, 1, and start the ignition and liftoff. Liftoff of
hypocritical, egotistical. Don't wanna be the parenthetical, hypothetical. Working out of something that I'm proud of. Out of the box, an epoxy to the world and the vision we've lost. I'm an apostrophe. I'm just a symbol to remind you that there's more to see. I'm just a product of the system of catastrophe. And yet a masterpiece. And yet I'm half deceased. And when I am deceased, at least I go down to the grave and die happily. Leave the body of my soul to be a part of me. I do what it takes.
Whatever it takes.
It's now my pleasure to introduce to you a Marine combat veteran on the ground and in the air, a four-time shuttle astronaut and American hero, Hall of Fame astronaut, and my friend, Colonel Jim Buckley.
Well, Bob, thank you very much for the nice introduction. You know, what he said about Minnesota and North Dakota kind of rings true, that in the state of North Dakota, there's only 600,000 people in the whole state. And about half of them live on the eastern border next to Minnesota. Well, in the summertime, everybody in North Dakota goes to Minnesota to go fishing and stay at their lake homes. And the rest of the people in North Dakota say that the IQ in both states goes up 15 points in the summertime. But I'm happy to be down here at KSC, I really am. I talked to my brother, who lives in North Dakota. 4 weeks ago, it was still 30 degrees below zero. And I'm so happy we're doing this down here at KSC. I'm equally happy, Bob, that you're at the helm steering our nation's premier launch center. I wish you all the best in the years to come. Now, my wife
of 49 years, Gene, our children's Jennifer and Jim, and Jim's wife Denise are here tonight. I would absolutely not be here without them. Gene is the rock of our family. Anthony, Jennifer's husband, is back in the hotel with little William, our four-year-old grandson. A month ago, we were visiting William. We don't visit our children, we visit William. And he and I were deep in conversation as he played with his Thomas the Train set. When Grandma Jean entered and asked, "What's going on?" William, while still playing with Thomas, said, "Grandma Jean, ignore Papa. He's just making things up." So my goal tonight is not to make things up. I came into the astronaut program by way of the Marine Corps Infantry. I, after a tour of duty in Vietnam, decided to switch my specialty to aviation for many good reasons, of which Bob had brought up a few. 8 years later, I found myself standing in front of the astronaut selection board. Those I remember directly in front of me were John Young, Joe Allen, Joe Kerwin, Carolyn Huntoon, and George Abbey, none of whom I had ever met. They asked me to relate any experiences I might have had which could be considered significant and where decision-making was important. I thought for a while. Then I told them of an experience on a long-range reconnaissance patrol where, at night, a young Marine next to me in our harbor site felt a snake wrap around his leg. We were in the midst of an enemy encampment when this occurred. He whispered to me, "Lieutenant, I think I have a snake on my leg." And I said, "Well, how big is it?" He replied, "I think it goes from my ankle to my thigh." After quickly wondering what I would do if it was on me, I calmly told him, "Well, it's cold-blooded, and it was just looking for warmth, and it should be gone in the morning." And it was. Well, everybody in the interview looked a bit stunned. I finished up and left, and about 5 months later, I got a call to join NASA's Astronaut Corps. And when I got there, I saw Joe Kerwin in the hall, and he said, "You're the guy with the snake story." Now, I'm not a big fan of reptiles, but I sure owe that snake a lot. Our first mission was to have been STS-10 in October of 1983. The failure of a rocket nozzle on an unmanned payload boost stage caused us to slip. And since it was a highly classified DOD flight, our crew stayed with the mission until we flew in January of 1985. During our wait time, our commander, T.K. Mattingly, did an outstanding job of keeping us ready. Many of you may know T.K. He could squeeze more out of a simulator session than anybody I know. We as rookies could not have asked for better training. And when we finally got to strap in on the launch pad before the main engines ignited, he just turned to us casually and he smiled and he says, "You're really gonna like this." I had no idea. Later during our first sleep period, I experienced bright tracers of light going through my eyes. And I thought, here I am on my first day of my first mission and I'm going blind. TK laughed and said my optic nerve and retina was being hit by high-speed radiation particles. They experienced the same thing on going to the moon. Who knew? Nobody told me. Later that same year, I was fortunate to have my second flight. We had a crew of 8, the largest crew size on any of the shuttle missions. My role was to be the shuttle systems expert on the red team. Well, during a night pass over South Atlantic, and the sun was coming up over Africa, I was looking out the overhead windows, and I started to see particles coming at us and bouncing off the shuttle. At first, it was just a few, and then it became hundreds. hitting us and ricocheting away. I woke up our commander, Hank Hartsfield. I didn't want to break his orbiter without him knowing about it. Hank got up and up on the flight deck, and we both watched until the particles stopped hitting us. We had no idea what had occurred. It turned out that we had reconnected with our own wastewater dump, which we had done the day before. I'm going to stop now. I told William that Papa wouldn't tell stories. But I'd like to say how honored and humbled I am to join the Astronaut Hall of Fame. The Astronaut Scholarship Foundation has done and continues to do remarkable things to ensure the technical future of our country is maintained. We need to do all we can in this effort. I'm excited for our future in space. I expect to see explorers back on the moon and on Mars in my lifetime. Those before us and my generation are passing the torch to future explorers. My hope is that we continue to push into the unknowns. Our nation must have the resolve to do just that. Let's continue to explore. Thank you.
I want to welcome up our presenter, our final presenter for tonight's gala. He is a veteran of five space flights. He's logged over 1,600 hours in space. He flew his pilot aboard STS-73, STS-80, and STS-85. He commanded STS-96 and STS-100. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Hall of Fame astronaut Kent Ruminger.
Good evening. First of all, you know, I view this kind of as an opportunity to roast. So right up front, I want to let everybody know that, hey, I have really enjoyed working with Janet. And so I thought I better get that out up front. How do I know Janet? In 2004, I'd been the chief of the astronaut office. I needed a deputy. I reached out to Janet because I knew Janet was capable, hardworking, low maintenance. Low maintenance is a term you can't say about all the astronauts in the astronaut office, but Janet truly was. And she said, sure, I'll be it. But you know, I had no idea how capable this astronaut really was. However, tonight we're here to talk about the human side, the side that is humans, which is code for, you know, we kind of do embarrassing things now and then, mess things up. So, and then it dawned on me, I go, I don't have any dirt on Janet. So I talked to her classmates, nothing. Talked to her shuttle crewmates, Charlie Precourt back at table 32. He was our commander. Charlie, what do you have on Janet? He goes, I don't have anything. Talk to Dom Gorey. So I go, okay, you know, I'm gonna talk to John, her husband. So I talked to John, and John said, hey, we met in college. She's really studious, studied hard, no wild party stories. He goes, by the way, she does everything at about 130%. Going, yeah, what about dirt, John? Help me out. He's like, hey, she's awesome, wife and mother, dedicated, loving, involved. And I witnessed her with her manager kids at the time that were in high school, and she knew every test, exam, what was coming up, what needed to be taken care of. Hobbies, anything there that something embarrassing had happened? I know I've had a few moments in hobbies. And they go, no, hey, she's this awesome cook, great bake, really gifted artist, a natural ability to draw, and could be probably professional if she dedicated the time. Musician, plays the piano, I'm gonna ask, so that doesn't work. He goes, hey, but she is a bit of a practical jokester. So he would be sitting at a stoplight, it would turn green, and he would press on the accelerator, and all that would happen is the engine would rev, and then people would start honking at him. And he'd look over, and Janet would just have that grin, and she had slipped the car into neutral. So. As well, one time he was eating dessert, it happened to be pudding. And he wasn't paying attention, went and grabbed something, and sure enough, Janet ate a bunch of it, filled it back in with ketchup, and then spread the pudding over the top. So John's next bite was mostly ketchup. Well, so now I'm kind of running out of ideas. She is the center director of the NASA Glenn Research Center. There's got to be something there. With her team, what did I find out? She seeks input. She relies on the team. She pulls them all together, figures out the path forward, and presses on. She's driven for results. Basically, hey, Janet's an outstanding leader. So, and back to the, hey, Janet's mind is always working at 130%. It is. And don't let that pleasant smile fool you. She is always thinking, and she's driven. In 2003, I was the chief of the astronaut office. Janet was a branch chief running the space station branch. I decided, hey, this would be a good time to take the 9 of the staff into southern Utah to the Canyonlands, go through leadership training with NOLS, National Outdoor Leadership School. And I thought, hey, I'll learn a lot about my crew. And they emphasize leadership, followership. I would get to see how the whole staff did. Janet was one of those staff members. And at the end of day one, the instructors came up and said, hey, you know, we also, you know, leadership, followership, but safety, risk-aware behavior we look out for. And you've got, you know, folks that are kind of getting dangerously close to cliffs as you're doing these trek along these canyons. I go, hey, great. And they go, that's you. I went, oh. So, you know, that kind of set a bit. I go, I need to be thinking about risk-aware behavior. Day 5, we're near the bottom of a cliff. And I look up, and about halfway up this 50-foot cliff, it's Janet. Janet. And then I'm looking around going, hey, where are the NOLS instructors, right? They need to call her out after calling me out. She comes back down, and I say, Janet, are you a rock climber? You must be a rock climber to have scaled this cliff, right? I get yelled at for just being close to it. You're on it. She's like, no. You know, we have these new Solo boots, and I just, you know, she wants to get everything out of every experience. And she probably didn't get called out because she was so capable. So she had no problem going up high on this cliff and coming back down. Adventurous. Could I get the photos up, those first photos? So recently, here's Janet flying in an F-15 out of Edwards Air Force Base. Awesome airplane, you know, and she's talking about, we took off, we did a vertical climb out in the F-15. We'll do that, stand right on the tail, go straight up. Fly low level. I did the flying. You know, this is just recently, and I could have been talking to a fellow fighter pilot, test pilot. She really, every opportunity she's offered, she tries to get the most out of it. Well, what about collaboration? Team player. Is she a team player? Is she collaborative? She is. I'm having a hard time with dirt, aren't I? Yeah. So, but I remember seeing a really good example of her team spirit. Back in 2001, a senior, very senior manager at headquarters at NASA decided that, you know, our astronauts need custom, tailored, skin-tight uniforms, flight suits, because they're out in public, and they'll look a lot better, just like the Blue Angels were. And we heard Jillian talk about the Blue Angels tonight. So Charlie Precourt happened to be the chief of the office, so, you know, this flowed down to him, so he decided, you know what, I know what I'll do. I'll model it, and I'll grab Janet to be the other model. We will model these custom-fit flight suits for the office on a Monday morning. Can I get the next slide, please? So I know Janet. And I'm sure when Charlie approached her in that nice smile, I was thinking, this is not going to be a good idea, Charlie, in front of 120 astronauts with 150 opinions, all but about 3 negative. But, you know, in true Janet style, she's like, sure, Charlie, right? Whatever you want me to do, we'll do it. So here they are. And, you know, so Janet kind of knew this wasn't going to go great. Charlie, though, you know, first of all, I think they both were great models, but I think Charlie was particularly excited to be in a Navy Blue Angels flight suit modeling this, knowing that he was an Air Force pilot. So,
kind of, and you know.
So I'm failing you all miserably this evening because I have no dirt. What I would like to do now is go ahead and roll the video that shows us Janet's career.
2, 1, 0, we have boosted ignition and liftoff of the Spatial Discovery as NASA embarks on the final mission to dock Russia's space station.
My very first shuttle flight, I went to the Mir space station. On my second flight, we did the Space Radar Topography mission.
We had to introduce some creative ways of tape change, and this is just one of those, which we refer to as the slam dunk tape change.
Mission, we helped construct the International Space Station by adding the airlock.
So glad to be back here again on another shuttle flight. First time to the space station.
Couldn't make a killing. Didn't have a dime, but I always had a vision. Always had high, high hopes.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And liftoff of Space Shuttle Atlantis, launching door to partnership in space.
It was a perfect touchdown. We could almost not feel it. It was just about perfect.
So in summary, you know, my search for dirt revealed Janet is the consummate professional, adventurous. Her CPU is always running at 130%, a very loving, dedicated wife, mother, multi-talented team player, gifted leader, but most importantly, all-around great person who's fun to work with. Please help me welcome the awesome Dr. Janet Cavani, Astronaut Hall of Fame member, to the podium.
So much for coming here tonight and for making us feel so special here. It's such an honor to be here. I know when I used to come to KSC all the time, and now less frequently, but still often, I would pass by the old rock, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but the Astronaut Hall of Fame. I'm from Cleveland now, so and I thought there is no way that I will ever get into that place. That's got to be just the ultimate place. No one like me would ever be able to get into that place. So I'm still just in shock that I'm actually standing here tonight. I came to NASA at just the perfect time. We were launching shuttles 5 or 6 times a year. My 1995 class, the Flying Escargot, we were an awesome group of people, and we had a great time traveling around to all the different centers, training, flying the T-38s, and running in the MBL. I even had a chance to do water survival training with John Glenn. That was amazing. I have a great shot of he and me in our underwear after we went into the water, and it's on my above my desk, and he signed it. Not the sexy kind, but you know, the full blue thing. But it's very important to me, and I just can't believe I'm at the center that's named after him now. So quite a special memory. My first flight was STS-91 with Charlie Precourt. The last mission to the Russian space station, Mir. And we flew the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer on that flight, so I'm very proud of that payload, and it's now on the International Space Station looking for antimatter. So pretty cool science. Charlie was my first commander, Dom Gorey, which was mentioned, who was mentioned earlier, was the pilot. I got to fly with him twice. Franklin Chang Diaz is here tonight. He was on that mission. Wendy Lawrence and Andy Thomas were other mission specialists. And we had a very distinguished senior Russian cosmonaut as well, Valery Buyumin, and he did a great job on educating us on the cultural differences between Americans and Russians. One of my very favorite space memories on that mission was looking out one of the Mir windows one evening, and cosmonaut Muzabayev took out his guitar. I don't know if Charlie remembers him. And he started to sing Beatles songs with a Russian accent. So it was kind of surreal. And I looked down and I saw that we had just passed over the state of Washington at sunset, and I could just see the pink tip of Mount Rainier as it disappeared into the darkness. And when it was completely dark, you could see the city lights as you cross across the United States. And as we passed over Kansas City, I wondered what the people down there in the state of Missouri would think if they would have known that 9 people, including a hometowner there, were passing overhead in a Russian space station with the commander belting out, "We all live in a yellow submarine." And how could you even describe that? So, one of my favorites. My second flight was STS-99, and that was a space radar topography mission. We mapped about 96% of the Earth's land mass in less than 2 weeks. And this data was the highest resolution three-dimensional surface map of the Earth to date that I'm aware of. It was so good, they won't even tell me how good it was, so I'm hoping it's pretty darn good. I told you earlier today that my dad had been a prisoner of war during World War II. Well, on that flight, we had a crew of 4 Americans, Kevin Kriegel, Dom Gorey again, Janice Voss, and myself. We had 1 Japanese, Mamoru Mori, and 1 German, Gerhard Thiele. And I know that my dad would have been so proud that we had come so far in that past 55 years that I was able to call Mamoru and Gerhard some of my dearest friends. The space program has really been such a great unifier of nations and of cultures. My last flight was STS-104, or 7A, of the ISS assembly sequence. We installed the airlock and 4 nitrogen and oxygen tanks on the space station. The crew members included Steve Lindsay, Jim Riley, Mike Gernhardt, and the great Santini. You know who that would be? Charlie Hobaugh, or Scorch, who idolized the great Santini movie. And talk about trial by fire on that mission. Scorch was the real reason for that little joke that Steve talked about earlier tonight. It was payback for all the times that he gave me a hard time during training. So later I had the opportunity to work with Rommel, as he described, as his deputy. That's where I learned the mastery of calm. I think my deputy here, Marla, she goes, "How did he learn to be so calm in meetings?" It was Rommel. One time I remember that some of our MOD or flight director brethren had come to the office. Rommel probably remembers that. And they were not at all happy about some of the crew members on board this shuttle wanting to talk to the chief of the astronaut office during, I think it was the return to flight mission. and they were very agitated. And they were so agitated that their voices were pretty raised. But Rommel was just so calm during the whole thing. And I thought if I could master the art of calm in that type of work situation, that maybe I could be management material someday. And I remember that Rommel, you know, had told me later in a performance evaluation, he said, "Janet, you know, you could be a center director someday." And, you know, I had never even thought about being in management. That was not my goal, much less a center director. But his confidence in me and just saying those words, that really meant a lot. And when I did become a center director someday, I called Rommel and I said, I remembered those words and how much they meant to me and how much they inspired me. So I really appreciate your confidence in me, Rommel. So remember, as we mentor these scholars here tonight, and I'm sure Jillian probably had someone who inspired her as well, as we motivate all those to whom we speak, they may not see in themselves what you see in them. They may not imagine a future that you can see for them. Sometimes we need to say the words of encouragement and give them the confidence that they need to do great things. We need them to do these great things to keep this planet and all the people on it safe and healthy for millennia to come. They truly are the guardians of the future, and we need them to have the fortitude to never give up. Thank you again for this tremendous honor and for sharing your passion for this amazing endeavor. Please enjoy the rest of your evening and safe journeys home. Thank you.
What an evening this has turned out to be. Janet and Jim, it has been a pleasure to honor you here this evening. I will have with me on stage very soon, here she comes, Justine of the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation, here to remind you of the raffle that we have that is still ongoing this evening. It's an Earthrise canvas signed by more than 25 astronauts from the Mercury, Gemini, Apollo, Skylab, and Shuttle programs. Help support our astronaut scholars. Tickets start at $30 each, four for $100, and the best deal is 10 tickets for $200. See the ladies in the back table. The raffle will be closing in 10 minutes. 10 minutes, so that's kind of your cue, too, if you want anything else, you best be getting it now, okay? All right, 10-minute warning on the raffle. All right, ladies and gentlemen, as we are getting ready to close out this evening, we would like to thank all of you for being here tonight to help celebrate the achievements of Jim Buckley and Janet Cavandi and to support the amazing astronaut scholars. And now we are going to draw the winning ticket for the Earth Canvas. All right, who's feeling lucky? All right, I have the winning ticket in my hands for the Earthrise canvas, and the winning number is 980-5533. It's a red ticket, last four digits, 5533. And we have a winner. All right, somebody is very happy that that has been won and will be kept in the family. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to our program's end. Thank you for joining us this evening. Please remember to take your 2019 U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame commemorative glass and the gift bag from our sponsors, as well as the commemorative autographed induction poster signed by James and Janet. If you are heading back to Kennedy Space Center, please exit out the south doors. If you are heading back to the hotel, please exit through the Apollo Treasures Room. Once again, if you're heading back to Kennedy Space Center parking lots, exit out the south doors. And if you're heading back to the hotel room, or to the hotel, please exit through the Apollo Treasures Room. Thank you all for coming. Good night, and may God bless each and every one of you.